But he wants to go, let's just go and get that. That's, I think, I never met him in my life, Jeff.
TV host.
I'll try.
I mean, if you get crazy, you can.
I might get crazy. You never know.
Hey, good to see you.
Oh, you know that.
Are we taking this now? Oh, okay.
So does that mean you gotta speak in Spanish?
Oh, okay. And there's a, is there a camera somewhere?
Okay.
Hello? Hello. Hi, everybody. I'm Russ Schaefer-Landau. I'm the director of the Parr Center for Ethics. I feel very bad standing right in front of one of our guests. Okay. And I want to welcome you all to tonight's event. I'm really excited about it. This has been one of the highlights of our programming plans over the past 6 or 7 months. And I'm delighted that it's coming to fruition tonight. I want to offer some thanks and one introduction. First, the thanks to all of you for showing up. And if you somehow managed to get into the room without seeing all those pizzas out there, there is pizza just waiting for you. And there's enough for seconds. Our partners tonight are from UNC, the Department of Philosophy, Poli-Sci, Public Policy, and the Campus Y, from Duke, the Department of Philosophy and the Keene Institute for Ethics, and the joint Duke-UNC PPE program. And tonight's sponsors are the Institute for Humane Studies and the John Templeton Foundation. One of our sponsors invites you to take a survey at your convenience after the conclusion of tonight's event. The URL is right there. It should take no more than 1 minute. Yeah, maybe 67 seconds, but no more than that. So you're all invited to do that. I want to just take this opportunity to announce a few of the upcoming events that the Parr Center is hosting. 168 hours from right now, that is next Thursday at this very time, in this very room, Emily Baxter, who's the executive director of the program We Are All Criminals, will be here to discuss basically challenging our assumptions about what separates people with criminal records from those who do not have those criminal records. And that will be moderated by Maya Walker, who's with the NC Second Chance Alliance. Next month, we've got a lot of great events coming up. There's going to be a talk by Maurice Mitchell Brody on the nonprofit industrial complex, a performance of the play Mariposa and the Saint, followed by a panel discussion about solitary confinement, a forum with Will Potter, who's a journalism professor from Michigan, and our own Richard Meyer at the law school, about ag-gag laws, body cam laws, and other laws that restrict public access to information. And there'll be a talk by renowned Michigan philosophy professor Peter Railton on a topic of contemporary ethical interest. And now it's my pleasure to introduce my colleague, Dr. Jeff Sebo, who's going to be tonight's moderator. Jeff is the associate director of the Parr Center, and he's a research assistant professor of philosophy here at UNC. Before joining us a year and a half ago, Jeff had positions at the National Institutes of Health in bioethics and in animal ethics and environmental studies at NYU, where he also got his PhD. Jeff works primarily in moral, political, and social philosophy. He's the co-author of a forthcoming book with Rutledge, whose title I should know, but I'm gonna look at it anyway: Food, Animals, and the Environment, an Ethical Approach. Jeff also serves on the boards of a number of nonprofit organizations that are focused on animal welfare. And without further ado, I hand it over to Jeff.
Thank you, Russ, and thank you everybody for being here. This is really exciting for me and for us to have everybody, and in particular, our two speakers. So my role is going to be to introduce the speakers, and then let me also tell you what the format of our discussion will be so you have a sense of what to expect. We have two people who disagree about boycotts in every respect and will be fighting to the death about boycotts. Shelley Kagan and Walter Sinnott Armstrong. Each of them will give an opening statement for about 15 minutes outlining their position about whether we make a difference when we participate in boycotts. I will then spend about 25 minutes asking them some questions to expand the discussion and get them into a back and forth. And then there will be about 25 minutes for audience Q&A. And then depending on who wins, if Shelley wins, everybody has to walk home and eat vegan food for the rest of their lives. And if Walter wins, then we can all drive gas-guzzling SUVs to eat foie gras somewhere. Okay. With that said, it's my great pleasure to introduce the following two people. Walter Sinnott Armstrong, over here, who will go first, is Chauncey Stillman Professor of Practical Ethics in the Department of Philosophy and the Keenan Institute for Ethics at Duke University. He is core faculty in the Duke Institute for Brain Sciences, Center for Cognitive Neuroscience, Center for blah, 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 millions of other things. He's published widely on ethics, theoretical and implied, and metaethics, empirical moral psychology and neuroscience, philosophy of law, blah, 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 many other things. Most recently, he is the author of Morality Without God, author of Moral Skepticisms, and editor of Moral Psychology, volumes 1-3. His articles have appeared in a variety of philosophical, scientific, and popular journals and collections. His current work is on moral psychology and brain science, uses of neuroscience and legal systems, and freedom and responsibility. So please, Walter, please welcome Walter Sinnott Armstrong. I'll introduce Shelley too and get it out of the way. So Shelley Kagan, right
blah,
here.
Blah, blah, blah.
He's written some things and taught some things. No. Shelley Kagan is the Clark Professor of Philosophy at Yale University. His main research interests lie in moral philosophy and in particular normative ethics. Much of his work centers on the debate between consequentialist and deontological moral theories, with publications on the nature of well-being, moral desert, 1S, utopia, and the connections between Kantianism and consequentialism. Kagan is a popular lecturer at Yale, known for his introductory lectures on death and ethics. His course on death has been turned into an open Yale course, which is particularly popular in China and Korea. He is also the author of three other books, The Limits of Morality, Normative Ethics, and The Geometry of Desert, again, 1S, along with dozens of articles. So please welcome Shelley Kagan. So Walter is now going to go first, and then Shelley will go after that.
Hi, so thanks to Jeff and to the Parr Center and to Russ and to Shelley for coming and to all of you for coming. I appreciate it. Our topic tonight is boycotts, and it's timely because a lot of people are talking about boycotting Trump products and companies that sell Trump products. Those are springing up, and there are bound to be more to come. And whenever there's a boycott, we have to decide, that is, you and I have to decide whether we are going to participate in it, whether we should participate, whether we must participate. It helps to think about these boycotts, these contemporary boycotts, in historical perspective. So one famous example was the Montgomery bus boycott, which was started by Rosa Parks in 1955. And for 381 days, many African Americans refused to ride on buses. They walked to work instead because they didn't want to support the practice of making African Americans sit in the back of the bus. That was actually eventually successful, and segregation was ended. So although that boycott is a paradigm case, many other things are also called boycotts. One example that I'm going to focus on is walking versus driving. It's another case of that, because some environmentalists refuse to drive whenever they can walk instead. They do so to avoid expelling greenhouse gases of the kind that lead to global warming. I'm going to call this a boycott in a very broad sense, although I recognize that that's stretching the term a little bit, and we can talk about its relation to more central cases of boycotts in the discussion period if we want to. So our question tonight is whether we, that again, you and I, are morally required to join this boycott. Conversely, is it morally wrong for us to refuse to join this boycott and then to drive our car when we could walk instead? So to make it concrete, I want to focus on a particular case. Just imagine that one Sunday afternoon, you've got a few free hours, you got nothing else to do, and you think to yourself, well, I could go for a walk, or I could go for a drive in the country, or I could sit on the couch and watch television, or I could take a nap. And you think about it, and you decide to go for a drive, and it's just beautiful, and the sun is shining, and the wind is in your hair, and you have a great time. But then the question arises, is that driving just for fun? That particular act, is it morally wrong? Now, it's crucial to understand the question that I'm trying to pose here. It's about a particular act. You might work all week long for environmental causes, right? You might drive a lot less than other people. But those are going to be questions about your character or you as a person. I want to focus in on the particular act and ask about whether driving for fun on that particular Sunday is morally wrong. I'm going to assume also that driving doesn't break any promise. You didn't promise your spouse or anybody you wouldn't go for joy rides. I'm not going to consider the chances of hitting a pedestrian because you're driving in the country where there's going to be very little chance of that. And I'm not going to talk about the health benefits of walking because I want to focus in on whether that particular act is wrong for the particular reason of expelling greenhouse gases. Notice also, I want to get this question straight. Notice that I'm not asking whether it would be better to go for a walk instead of a drive. It might be, but the fact that something is better doesn't mean that doing something else is morally wrong. Many times, acts are not morally wrong, even though something else would be better. I mean, just imagine there are two charities, and maybe it'd be better to give to charity A, but you don't like charity A. You don't like the people in that charity, or this, for some reason, charity B just appeals to you more. And so you help out this other charity, even though you admit it would be better. I don't think it's wrong for you at that point to help out charity B. In fact, you helped out a charity. You helped people in need. That was a good thing to do. So, similarly, with the case of walking versus driving, it might be that neither of them's morally wrong. You could go for a walk, you could go for a drive, it's up to you. And that, in fact, is my position. I'm not saying that it would be wrong not to go for the drive, of course. I'm saying that neither walking nor going for the joyride is going to be morally wrong. And last, I want to clarify that this position does not deny, and I do not deny, that global warming is a serious problem. It's a very serious problem. And there's very strong evidence that it's caused by human activity, including driving, among other things, that expel greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. I also want to agree that if enough people did enough different actions to stop expelling greenhouse gases, then all those actions together would reduce global warming and reduce harm. That's, I think, why it seems better to walk than to drive. But it still doesn't show that it's wrong for you to drive, so it doesn't yet answer the question that I want to focus on. So what would do that? Well, if you had a moral principle and you argued from that principle to this particular act to show that it was wrong, then that would do it if the principle was justified. Now, many principles could be cited, and I'm going to focus on one particular kind of principle, because it's one that interests me and Shelley, both being consequentialists of sorts, and also because I think it's central to the discussions. But if you want to bring up others in the discussion period, we can talk about other arguments and other principles as well. The one I want to focus on is the common argument that driving for fun on a Sunday afternoon is morally wrong because it causes or results in some kind of harm. Perhaps surprisingly, I want to deny that. I want to say that driving for fun doesn't cause any harm at all. I don't deny that it causes greenhouse gases. Of course, when you would go for the drive, you're going to expel some CO2 into the atmosphere that would not have been expelled if you had not taken the drive. But CO2 is not a harm. In fact, carbon dioxide is necessary for life. We need a certain amount of carbon dioxide. So that itself is not a harm. The harms are death, pain, and disability caused by storms or high seas or floods that result from global warming. It's the death, pain, and disability that are the harms. And so the question in applying this principle to driving for fun is whether driving for fun causes any of those harms, death, pain, or disability. So to answer this question, I think we have to think a little bit about what counts as causation. On most accounts, X causes Y only if the presence or absence of X makes a difference to the presence or absence of Y. If you drive, certain CO2 molecules enter the air. If you don't drive, those molecules don't enter the air, or at least not at that time. So that's why driving makes a difference and causes those CO2 molecules to enter the air. In contrast, your driving for fun does not make any difference to global warming. If you drive, there's going to be global warming. If you don't drive, there's still going to be global warming. Global warming is inevitable either way. We've already put way too much CO2 into the atmosphere. Natural processes are putting more. We're continuing to put more. We can't stop that. It's sad, but that's the facts. That's the way it is, and we have to face that. So our not driving is not going to change any of that. Now, critics might reply that, well, driving for fun, it might not cause global warming, but it can still contribute to global warming in the sense of making it worse. But how much does it contribute? What some philosophers do is they take the amount of CO2 you would expel if you went for this drive for fun, take how much is the percentage of that of the entire CO2 in all the atmosphere. Then you get a certain percentage, and you multiply that by the amount of harm caused by global warming, and then they try to attribute that amount of harm to your particular act of driving by dividing it down into parts. Okay, I think what we need to ask is whether this calculation makes any sense, and I want to say it doesn't make any sense if you think about it. It would make sense in other kinds of cases. You know, if you have a quart of oil that weighs 2 pounds and has about 3 × 10^25 molecules, then you can figure out how much a molecule weighs by taking the weight of the oil and dividing by the number of molecules, and then you get the weight of a particular molecule. That's going to be fine because the properties are aggregative in the sense that, look, the parts have weight and the whole has weight. The properties of one of the parts are going to be parts of properties of the whole. But there are other cases that are not like that. Consider sliminess. A quart of oil is very slimy. However, an individual molecule of oil is not slimy. It's not that it has a little bit of sliminess. It doesn't have any sliminess at all because you can't even feel an individual molecule of oil. So it can't feel like slime. So that's a property that I want to call emergent. It's a property that the whole has, the oil as a bunch, but the parts, the particular molecules, do not have. And in my view, global warming is emergent, and that's crucial to my position. Whether there's global warming depends on overall worldwide levels of greenhouse gases. It doesn't depend on which molecules are in the air, or where they are, or where they came from. The causal relations actually hold between patterns rather than between individual bits of gas. And hence, the individual bits of gas don't cause even parts of the effects of those of the global levels. So the greenhouse gases expelled by driving for fun don't cause global warming or storms or deaths or anything of that sort. They don't cause even part of those effects. To say so is to confuse the level at which the causation operates. It operates at the level of the overall patterns rather than of the individual parts. And that's why it's not legitimate to calculate the harm of driving for fun by multiplying the whole by the proportion that you're expelling on that occasion. Now, the story would be somewhat different if there were some kind of precise threshold. Imagine that there's so much CO2 in the atmosphere that another molecule would tip the balance and cause a storm, which would cause a death. Then, when your driving adds a few molecules to the atmosphere, those molecules have some slight chance of putting us over the threshold and causing harm. The chances are very small, but the harms are great, so the expected utility might be very negative. However, that argument assumes that there is a precise threshold, but there's no such precise threshold in global warming. A few molecules are not going to make the difference between a storm or no storm. Indeed, the molecules that you expel by driving don't even add to the storm's strength. It's not as if you're expelling extra water molecules that are going to make the rain heavier than they were before. That's just not how it works. The most they might do is play a small role in trapping a little bit of extra heat from the sun, but we need some heat to be trapped. That's part of the natural process. And there's no way to say that the molecules that you expel are responsible for for putting it over a particular level or threshold. Okay, so some critics reply that driving for fun can still increase the probability or risk of harm by increasing the probability that we'll pass some threshold. I'm trying to, you know, go through different variations of this position. These critics aren't claiming that driving for fun is going to raise the probability of global warming. It can't raise that probability since that's inevitable. Instead, they claim that driving raises the probability of some harmful event, such as a storm or a flood. Well, I deny that too. Just as with global warming in general, what increases the probability of a storm or a flood is the overall temperature or level of greenhouse gases instead of the particular molecules, which after all leave my car and get spread throughout the entire world. To see the point, compare a giant flood of water rushing down the Mississippi River, and I pour a quart of water into the river at St. Louis, or a gallon. It mixes widely throughout millions and millions of other gallons in the giant floodwaters. And it seems to me there's no chance at all that the molecules from my gallon will cause a levee to break down in New Orleans. If the molecules from my gallon had not hit that levee, then what would have happened? Other molecules would have hit the levee and the same thing would have happened. It's a big flood after all, and there are millions of gallons rushing down. So there's no chance at all that my particular molecules will make a difference to whether the levee breaks. That's just not how levees break. So the flood would have happened anyway and the harms would have happened anyway, and one more gallon doesn't make any difference. Similarly, the levels of CO2 in the atmosphere are already so high and growing so fast that adding a few extra molecules by driving for fun is not going to make any difference to any harm. Let me make one more point, which I owe to Ewan Kingston. Even if I'm wrong about causation and thresholds and probability, which I've discussed so far, we still need to ask, what would happen if I did not expel any greenhouse gases? The answer is clear. If my car hadn't been on the road, there would have been another car right after it, which would have expelled greenhouse gases. It's not like if I don't drive, other people aren't going to drive either. So the most that my driving can make as a difference is to slow the process down by a couple of seconds. The gases are going up. If I don't do it, it's just going to happen a little bit later. And it ends up being the same harm, regardless of when it occurs. So my driving doesn't cause any harm. It only affects the timing, and the timing is not morally relevant. It's not even clear that storms are going to be sensitive to the fact that the gas entered the atmosphere a few seconds later. So it doesn't seem like that kind of effect can really be relevant to the harms. Finally, in case you're not convinced by any of that, I imagine that some of you still think that driving for fun does cause some harm and that those effects are enough to make driving wrong. Notice that this argument assumes a principle, that it's morally wrong to expel unnecessary greenhouse gases. And if you're going to apply that principle to this case, you have to apply the same principle to other cases. If it makes it wrong in this case, it's going to make it wrong in those cases. And think about what that's going to exclude. It's going to mean you can't go jogging. You can't even go for a walk. You've got to sit on the couch. Right? We got to turn the lights off here. You can't be cooking your vegetables at night. You got to eat them raw. You can't take a warm shower. You've got to take a cold shower. All of those things are going to be unnecessary uses of greenhouse gases. And so they're going to be wrong on exactly the same basis, if, in fact, driving for fun is wrong. And I think that result is absurd. Any theory that invades our lives to that extent just demands too much of us. If it's not wrong in those cases, it can't be right. If it's not right in those cases, it can't be right in the case of global warming as well. Or at least it can't be wrong to drive just for fun on the grounds that it causes harm by expelling greenhouse gases. That can't be the right reason. Of course, there might be other reasons. You might ask, well, what if everybody did it? You might ask, well, you know, what if we're not doing our fair share to fight the problem? Those are going to be separate principles that I'll have to talk about later because I'm running out of time. And I'll be happy to respond to them during the discussion period. So in closing my opening remarks, let me remind you of what I don't claim. I admit that global warming is a very, very serious problem. I admit that it's caused by human activities, including greenhouse gases, that expel greenhouse gases, including driving just for fun. I admit that refraining from driving might be morally good, it might be virtuous, it might be ideal, it might be nice if we did it. My thesis is only that driving for fun on one occasion is not morally wrong on the grounds that it causes harm. Now, another topic that I've not addressed is whether other boycotts follow the same pattern as global warming. My answer is some do and others don't, because not all causation is emergent in the way causation is in the case of global warming. Recall the Montgomery bus boycott that I described. There, if one black person were to get on the bus, then that might, in fact, encourage other black people, discourage them from boycotting. Then they would end up getting on the bus, and the whole thing could break down because of the symbolic value and the communication between people and the visibility of what's going on. It might encourage the bus companies to keep going and try to make it through the boycott because they think it's likely to end, and so on. The symbolic value would be very important there. But that's not the case with going for a joyride. It's not like I'm going to go encourage everybody else to do a joyride, and even if I did, that wouldn't change what they do. So it's not going to have anything like that type of effect. And that's why I think the greenhouse gas is different from other boycotts. They're just not a uniform group, and we have to look at each boycott one by one. So there's a lot more to discuss, a lot more types of boycotts, but I'm out of time now. So I want to thank you for listening. I look forward to your questions.
I'm going to try sitting on the table because that's my preferred lazy mode of lecturing. I'm not going to try answering every point that Walter raised. I want to lay out the way I see the issues, although to a significant extent, we, despite what Jeff said, we agree about a lot of this. In particular, I think the crucial question is going to be whether or not my behavior makes a difference. That is there any realistic chance? What should we think about, you know, driving, not driving? As Walter says, there's lots of other cases. And so let me start by making just some general remarks. So the kind of things we're thinking about is either a lot of us are doing things and the net result of all our doing these things is something really bad, or maybe if we all did something, the net result would be really good. Presumably, like in the driving case, I get something out of the driving. You know, it's the pleasant time. Walter's hair is waving in the wind, right? And so the thought's got to be something like, you know, whether or not we should even be talking here about the boycott depends in part on how much you're getting out of taking the drive versus how bad, assuming for the moment that it's legitimate to talk about your share, how bad your share of global warming is. And that's why I of course agree with Walter that, you know, if you up the cost to me of boycotting, and now I have to eat my vegetables in the shower while I'm taking the lights off, you know, it's yeah, that's a pretty serious cost. And so the kinds of cases that we're most interested in, I think, are the ones where, again, assuming it were mathematically assuming it were morally legitimate to think of the, you know, I'm one of N people together causing global warming, and so I've got one nth of the bad. Assuming that the good I get by my driving on the weekend is less than my share of the bad, so that's the kind of case that we're interested in. What we need to figure out is whether or not it's morally appropriate to say that I've got kind of one nth of the blame. And that's going to depend on what you think is the relevant micro story about how the bad, how our individual actions together add up to the bad result. I'll offer a couple of models in a second. I just want to make one other remark, kind of preliminary. I certainly agree, of course, as well, that, you know, if I don't drive, it's not like global warming goes away. But of course, nobody here was moved by that thought because after all, that's like saying, you know, so here's a massacre. You know, we're all busy killing, you know, the Jews, and I'm about to kill one more. And you know, if I didn't kill one more Jew, it'd still be a massacre. Nobody's going to think that's any kind of relevant argument for us whether or not I should be, you know, killing one more of the Jews. So again, the question is really, do I make a difference, right? Because of course there'll be a smaller massacre if I don't kill one more Jew, and that's the relevant question we want to have. Will there be less global warming if I don't do it. So here's a couple of possibilities. I don't actually think what I'm about to say applies to the global warming case, because it's kind of a no-brainer. If things work like this, we wouldn't be here wondering about it. If every single action made that one nth of a difference, so the n of us together produced global warming, and if I didn't drive, there'd be one nth fewer car drivings, and so there'd be one nth fewer amount of global warming, then we'd all say, since by hypothesis we're thinking about a case where the bad, my share of the bad, is greater than the individual good I got by going for the drive, then we'd all say, okay, yeah, the bad that you're producing outweighs the good, and so obviously you shouldn't do it, special circumstances aside. All right, but that's not what's going on, as Walter is emphasizing in the global warming case. He also said, look, what you might think, he doesn't think, but you might think, and indeed I do think, it's more like this, there's a certain number of us such that if we stopped driving, there'd be a significant amount less global warming. So just to kind of get our heads around it, just pretend, because this is obviously completely unrealistically simplified, suppose there's just 100 of us together by driving create global warming. And then if you had a situation where if only 90 of us were driving instead of 100 of us, then there'd be, one-tenth less global warming. And if only 80 of us were driving instead of 90 of us, there'd be two-tenths less global warming. So as Walter pointed out, in a situation like that, the relevant moral thought would be something like, if I'm part of a group of 10 people who've decided not to drive, then we together will have reduced global warming by one-tenth. What are the chances that I'll be one of the 10? Suppose that there was these kind of triggering threshold levels, 90, 80, 70, one fewer icebergs melt, or whatever it might be. The flood only makes it 10 feet less high up, and so fewer people drown on the shore. If that was the way it worked, then it wouldn't have to be that every single individual action reduced the bad effects of global warming by your bit. But if 10 of us together reduced, stopped driving, then there'd be 10 units or 10 shares of global warming reduction. And so if you do the math, you do the expected utility calculation, you say in the absence of special information to the contrary, what's going on is, what are the chances? Well, it could be that 87 people are going to drive today, or maybe 85 people are going to drive today. What are the chances that I'm part of a group of 10 people who decide not to drive today? One of the even, the tens. You'd have, roughly speaking, a 1 in 10 chance of being in a group that was large enough to cross one of these thresholds. And so when you do the expected utility calculation, you'd have, a 1 in 10 chance of having reduced global warming by 10%. And so that's still, your expected utility is the 1%. It's not as though you actually do necessarily reduce by that 1%. It's rather that you've got a certain chance of being part of a group that will make this larger difference because of these thresholds. Now, Walter conceives all this, and he just thinks that's not the right way to think about global warming either. The right way to think about global warming, Walter says, is nobody's individual's action makes a difference. And again, here we don't mean to the question, can you eliminate global warming, right? That's not going to happen. But that nobody individual's actions makes a difference. The following thing is supposed to be true about this kind of case, and indeed a lot of other cases that have this structure. That if none of us do the action in question, the results are good overall, no global warming. And if enough of us do it, suppose it's 100, then the results are bad. Global warming, with all that death and destruction, far greater than the benefits we get by having the wind sweep through our hair on the on the sunny days. So, but what's supposed to be interesting about this case, and morally kind of distressing, is that no for each individual, it's supposed to be true to say that if you hadn't driven, no matter how many other people are driving, if you hadn't driven, the results would have been exactly the same. A few more molecules here and there can't make a difference to the amount of ice melting and the how much flooding there is and so forth. Right? And so if that's the right way to think about the case, and Wolf, of course, thinks it is, then we think, oh, okay, so from in terms of consequences, we can't really justify boycotting because you're not making your individual actions not making a difference. It's going to be exactly as bad. And what I want to say is I know it's very tempting to think that that's the right structure. I actually think that's not the right structure. And the reason I think it's not the right structure is because I actually think no case ever could conceivably, not just as a matter of empirical fact, as a matter of kind of math, no case could have that structure. So I want to say the kind of case that Walter thinks global warming is in fact impossible. Obviously, if it's impossible, global warming doesn't have that structure. How much time have I got left?
Oh, you're good.
Yeah, but how good is good?
Take 7 more minutes.
Okay, good. So you may actually have to prove what I just said. That's a pity. Okay, so here's the kind of case. I'm going to make it very, very, again, simpler. Because, of course, the numbers are much larger with global warming. But the idea is supposed to be that if none of us do it, there's no bad effect. If, let's say, 100 of us do it, there's this really, really bad effect. And yet it's supposed to be true that if 27 people do it, the effect's no different than if 26 people had done it. You know, for any number of people that are doing it, it's supposed to be that the results would have been exactly the same if one person more had done it, one person less had done it. Here's the argument that says that can't possibly be true. All right, so suppose we start with nobody doing it, then we've got a good effect. Now imagine one person doing it. By hypothesis, no addition, if the case has the kind of structure Walter's saying it has, by hypothesis, no addition over the number you previously had makes any difference. Since no people doing it has a good effect, one person has to have the same effect as no people doing it. Since no people doing it has a good effect, one person doing it has a good effect. Okay, now suppose we ask ourselves, what would be true if two people did it? Again, by hypothesis, one person's action can't make any difference. So the result of two people doing it has to be exactly the same as the result of one person doing it. Because we just saw one person doing it, by hypothesis, is supposed to be no problem at all. So two people's got to be no problem at all. You can see how this argument's going to go. So three people's got to be no problem at all. So 27 people's got to be no problem at all. So 98 people's got to be no problem at all. 99's got to be no problem at all. And 100's got to be no problem at all. Because for each case, as you added that extra person, it made no difference, right? And so that means by kind of zipping back, we had to have with 100 people doing it exactly the same result that you would have had if no people had done it, which was good. But by hypothesis, the idea is supposed to be that if 100 people do it, the result is bad. That's obviously a contradiction. So something in our assumptions have gone wrong. It's not controversial here that if nobody's driving, we don't have global warming. If everybody's driving, we do have global warming. So the only assumption left to challenge here is the one that says it's possible to have cases with this kind of structure where each individual action, it's true of it, that if they hadn't done it, the results would have been exactly the same. I have just proven, I believe, that that cannot conceivably be the case, which means that the global warming case does not have the structure Walter takes it to have. What it actually has, I think, is something more like the threshold structure, where, and again, we don't have to think that there's a precise number, but we think that, you know, there's a certain number of reductions in drivings that would reduce by a noticeable, morally significant amount, the amount of damage from global warming. And no doubt there are many such places along the way, you know, given the hundreds and millions of us who are contributing to pollution, there are many such numbers. Maybe it takes 1,000 people to get the first noticeable reduction and another 1,000 to get the next reduction, or 10,000, whatever it might be. But there's going to be these thresholds. And so what each one of us can say is, I may not be part of a group that's about to cross one of these thresholds, but it is the case for all that, that there's a chance you know, maybe if it takes 1,000 to cross another threshold, then I've got a 1 in 1,000 chance of being part of a group that would cross that threshold. Now, and if that's right, then you do the expected utility calculation and so forth and so on, and then you end up saying, oh, so now it turns out that I really shouldn't be driving after all. Now, of course, there can be exceptions. I mean, suppose the following thing was the case, and I'm here, supposed to try to wrap up. Suppose the following thing were the case, that in order to reduce this is certainly not plausible, but you'll see the kind of the extreme version of the case. Suppose that in order to actually make, we've now put so much greenhouse gases into the atmosphere that in order to do anything at all to reduce the suffering and destruction, every single person on the planet would have to stop driving. Well, that's never going to happen. If that's what it would take to cross the threshold, then of course you would know for a certainty you're not going to be part of a group that's going to cross the threshold. Less extreme, you know, if scientists told us that, you know, 10% is too much, 90% of all people on Earth have to eliminate, kind of contributing to the carbon footprint and so forth before we cross any threshold at all, then you might say, no, we're never going to get that at all. But that's a much stronger claim than anything that Walter gave us any reason to believe in. It's one thing to say, if so many are doing that, even if you took away 10, 20, 100, 1,000, a million, you know for sure you'd never cross the threshold, well, then there'd be no point in doing it, at least in terms of would your action make a difference. But we don't know that about our situation. It is plausible to think that if enough of us, and it doesn't have to be all of us, did less to pollute, then there'd be a reduction of a significant amount in the amount of global warming and the suffering that produces. And so I do think, since we are in these kinds of triggering cases, as far as we can tell, the expected utility calculation says, roughly speaking, you may not make a difference, but there's a chance that you'll make a difference. The chance may be small, but if that chance were actualized, the payoff would be great enough that morally it makes sense for you to participate. All right, there's much more to be said about it, but I think that's enough for now.
No, okay, thank you to Shelley and Walter. Now I'm going to ask some questions designed to expand the discussion and to think about some other moral considerations, as well as some other kinds of boycott, so that we can bring some more issues into the conversation. And then we can have a group discussion and you can all ask questions and make comments as well. So the first question that I have for you is, so far the debate has been about a fairly narrow, though very important issue, of course, which is whether we make a difference with respect to global harms like anthropogenic climate change when we participate in boycotts, for example, driving a gas-guzzling car. So the discussion has been about, do we make a difference with respect to these global harms? One might wonder whether making a difference is the right way to think about our moral obligation to participate in boycotts. So a different view might be, I have a moral obligation to participate in a boycott because I should not be part of a group that causes harm, independently of whether or not I make a difference at all. I have a moral obligation not to participate in harmful practices, whether or not I make a difference. I wonder if you find that view plausible, or if you really do think it hangs on whether I make a difference.
You want to go?
So, I think merely being part of a group that causes a harm is not going to be enough. Example I give in my article was Bush, you know, issued back, I think it was $600 to every taxpayer in this, you know, big tax break. Now, I think actually cashing that check, everybody cashing their check, harmed the country. Namely, it increased the deficit and created problems in the way the government was running and produced all kinds of harms. But I don't think there's anything wrong with me cashing my check when I know everybody else is going to cash theirs anyway, and $600 less in the deficit isn't going to make any difference. So there might be some cases where you're being part of a group that causes a harm does make a difference, like in the case of killing a bunch of people in a prisoner of war camp. But that's because you're killing that one person right there. You know, they're right in front of you, and you did it intentionally, and that's a very different situation than the kinds of cases we're talking about. So sometimes it might, but it certainly doesn't always make it wrong that you're part of a group that's causing harm.
So I have a,
a slightly different take on it, although the bottom line is the same. I don't think appeal to participation and complicity per se does it. So let me just sort of step back. Walter said in his very opening sentence to that he and I share a kind of broad commitment to an approach to ethics called consequentialism. And the thought behind that is that right and wrong's a matter of the results of what you're doing. And that's why it's important to me to try to make the case that I was just trying to sketch, that really there's a chance that you will make a difference, and why Walter, having the opposite view about whether or not you really will make a difference in terms of your individual action, why, given his conclusion that you won't, he thinks, well, you know, so it's okay to continue driving. So people who think, like Walter, that your individual action won't make a difference, but who are not so wed to the consequentialist way of thinking about it, sometimes start saying, here's what we need to introduce into our moral theory. We need to introduce some kind of prohibition against participating or being complicitous in the group. You're part of the group that together make this mess. And it doesn't really matter whether or not your individual action made a difference. It's morally objectionable to be part, right? Now, my own view is that there's no way to make that principle work without sneaking in at some point some view about whether or not your action made a difference. Because suppose, it would be one thing if what we all did was, you know, we were members of the Nazi Party and we've got our little ID in our wallets. You know, I've got my ACLU membership card in my wallet, right? So yeah, I'm a card-carrying member of the ACLU, right? But of course, that's not what's going on in the pollution case, right? None of us are, I'm a card-carrying member of the Let's Destroy the Environment Club. So the question is, who is participating? Now, here would be a natural answer. Anybody who, if they didn't do what they were doing, the results wouldn't be so bad. That would be one way to identify who's participating. Look, suppose that we say, for example, here's all, you want to, you know, people who are attracted to complicity want to point to all the people who are driving the cars and say, those are the ones who are participating. Now, take the person who's staying at home in Walter's shower in the dark eating the vegetables. Now, why aren't they one of the participants? Why aren't they somebody who also gets tarred and feathered with the charge of, you know, you were complicitous, you were part of the group, you know? And what answer can we possibly give other than, of course I wasn't part of the group, because of course, if I hadn't been in the shower or been, you know, whatever, sitting in the library instead, the results would have been exactly the same. I think there is no way, in the absence of card-holding membership, to pick out who's part of the group that you want to condemn, except by smuggling in an appeal to who made a difference. And that's where I think appeal to complicity won't really solve the problem if we can't already solve it in consequentialist terms.
Okay, great, thank you. So another way that we can expand the discussion is by extending this conversation to other kinds of boycotts. So the initial focus has been on boycotting practices that contribute to global climate change. There are all sorts of different distinctions we can make about kinds of boycotts, though. So, for example, we can distinguish coordinated boycotts from uncoordinated boycotts. So this might be an example of an uncoordinated boycott, where we each decide for ourselves whether or not to be part of the problem or part of the solution, maybe identifying our participation by our impact. We can also distinguish boycotting harmful practices from boycotting businesses, from boycotting states, and different reasons for doing that, maybe because of the direct harm they cause, maybe also for the political opinions they express along the way. So do you regard any of these distinctions, so coordinated, uncoordinated, boycotting practices, businesses, states, boycotting them for direct impact versus indirect impact? Do you think any of that makes a difference in terms of the difference we can make as participants or the ethics of having an obligation to participate?
Good. I guess I would say sometimes, coordination makes a difference sometimes. That was my example of the Montgomery bus boycott. When it's coordinated and some people break the line, that discourages others and then there's a chance it's going to break the whole thing down. You know, partly because it's such a local thing and the coordination is crucial. to it. So I think, you know, the differences among boycotts sure do make a difference sometimes. There are some boycotts that I think, yes, you are, you know, probably morally required to participate in those boycotts. Those are going to be the rare exceptions. Because if we say that people are morally required to participate in every boycott, they're just, you know, there's going to be a lot of things you can't do, and there's going to be a lot of time you're going to be spending, you know, boycotting this and that and this and that. So I would much rather take the view that it'd be ideal, be nice if you participate in the boycott, but you have some freedom in deciding which ones you're going to do, and you don't have to do them all.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to say something close, but I'm going to, as usual, take much longer to say it than Walter. So remember, I sketched an argument, the upshot of which was that there aren't really cases where your action is individual action guaranteed not to make a difference, unless you know for a certainty that you have too many people performing the relevant action. In the kind of cases that actually arise, what you've got is a chance of being part of a group that will cross some threshold. Now, what I said was, in the absence of information, then you have no reason to think the cohort people participating is going to be this size versus that size, and so you've got to assign equal probabilities to each of the sizes of the possible participants in the boycott, and the expected utility calculations come out supporting doing the boycott. What coordination does is it changes the information you've got. If you know that there's a group that's organizing publicity successfully, this is gaining traction, it's snowballing, that of course makes it all the more likely that if you join the boycott, the next threshold will be crossed. When you've got lack of any kind of coordination, you're back on kind of just, I don't know anything special. In fact, it could in principle go the other way. So you could imagine the friends of gas guzzling cars calling you up on the phone saying, you know, we've got an exact count of every human being who's going to be driving a car, you know, in the next 6 months or what have you. And it's going to, and we know exactly, our science has now gotten to the point where we know exactly how many people it's going to take. It would take 1,000 fewer people driving before we get any reduction in global warming. And we're only going to have 900 people refraining. So you're driving, not driving, is only going to make the difference between 900 and 901 people refraining. No matter what you do in that case, there is no chance you're going to be part of a group that will cross the threshold. Well, again, that would be a kind of coordinated anti-boycott, I suppose. And again, if you knew that, then indeed at that point, you would know for a certainty it would make no difference. But the thing that coordination does is it gives you information which allows you to change your calculations.
Okay, great. So one other question I think that a lot of people have about boycotts is that, and Walter mentioned this in his comments, is that boycotts are extremely demanding in part because of how many harmful practices and businesses and everything else there are in the world. So you might think that if you do have a moral duty to participate in boycotts, then that would multiply and all of a sudden there would be nothing that you could permissibly purchase, nothing you could permissibly do. Whereas if not, then it might seem that you would be free to participate in a lot of seemingly harmful practices. And that raises all sorts of concerns. One concern for many people is that boycott is an elitist form of protest because you have to have a certain kind of socioeconomic standing in order to be able to participate in boycotts. Another concern is just that if we do have a duty to participate in boycotts, then this will be very demanding, and you might wonder if morality is this demanding, and especially if we now live in a world where most of the most pressing harms are this sort of global harm rather than local individual harms. You might wonder that your view commits us to a not demanding enough morality, and that your view commits us to a too demanding morality, right? Because you might think, on one hand, that if we accept Walter's view, then we don't make a difference when we participate in global harm. So we can have 15 children, and we can eat whatever we want, and we can drive gas-guzzling cars everywhere, and we don't have to worry about voting, because of course voting probably won't make a difference in the individual case. We don't have to worry about going to protest, because whether one more person goes to a protest, that won't make a difference. Although there might be some stuff about coordination there that, that changes things. But you might worry that on this view, we're just permitted to do too much. And then similarly on your view, you might worry, well, does that mean I can't permissibly have children? I can't permissibly eat lots of things. I can't permissibly take flights anywhere. And that might seem to be too demanding. So I wonder if you could talk about whether your view is not demanding enough, and then if you can talk about whether your view is too demanding.
Sure. On my view, it's not a good thing to have 15 kids. It's a bad thing to have 15 kids. I just don't want to say it's wrong. There's a force to wrong that suggests that this person deserves some kind of public, sanction and censure of a sort that I think, is not appropriate in that case. I can still say of a lot of those things that you mentioned, it'd be great if you did those things. I encourage you to do those things. If you do those things, I will pat you on the back and call you a good person and invite you to my birthday party. But I'm not going to, if you don't do those things, go, you're a jerk. I'm going to tell everybody they ought not to invite you to their birthday party. And I'm going to see if we can pass a law against you and get you to stop doing that. Right? So when I say it's not demanding, I mean, yeah, we're not, I think it, we shouldn't be putting those demands on each other. It's going to be a lot more constructive if environmentalists encourage the people that go along with them, say, that's great that you're vegetarian or vegan, but not go, hey, you're only vegetarian, not vegan, you schmuck. You're doing the wrong thing. That is not going to be a productive and useful way for us to think about our moral relations to other people.
So brief follow-up, and then I'd like Shelley to chime in. Why should I, if I accept your view, why should I even pat people on the back or call them good people for abstaining from these practices if they genuinely don't make a difference? And if it genuinely doesn't make a difference that I pat them on the back, why should I even do that?
Well, first of all, it doesn't impose any harm on anybody to pat them on the back. So I pat people on the back all the time for almost no reason. Good job. So what the hell? Now, is it going to do any good? Maybe not.
That's assault in some states.
So I think, I tend to say the grounds for encouraging can be quite slight. And I would love to have you as part of the group because it'll make the group happier and better. But I'm not going to, impose negative sanctions on you for failure.
Shall we?
So I actually agree with the central point of what Walter just said, which is, if you look at it from a consequentialist perspective, if we go around complaining or worse about anybody who falls short of making their maximal contribution to making the world a better place, you're not going to end up encouraging people to make their maximal contribution. You're just going to discourage everybody. And so this needs to be parsed out more prudentially or with an eye towards encouraging people. So people who are doing more than average should be encouraged. Pats on the back or verbal, attaboys or attagirls or whatever it might be. And we should save our condemnation for people who are towards the bottom. On the other hand, you originally asked the question about, is the morality that I believe in too demanding? Notice that the question about how demanding morality is really orthogonal to the question that we've been, Walter and I are disagreeing about. I mean, even if it was just a matter of, I suppose that for every $10 I give to Oxfam, I could save a life. In fact, that's true, right? And so here there's not a matter of can you make a difference, it's just the case. You could make a difference by going home and emptying out your bank account, your checking account, and writing the check to Oxfam. And so even when we've settled the question, could you make a difference, is still the question, and how much of a sacrifice do you have to make the difference you can make? Now, as it happens, I also happen to believe you've got some pretty hefty moral obligations here, far more than what most of us are comfortable admitting to ourselves. But as I said, that's really a debate for, I think for a different day. But there's one other point that your opening question raises, which I want to touch on, kind of the know, the hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands of boycotts and consumer choices that they might want to make. I really should learn the person I'm about to, the name of the person I'm about to quote, because I quote them enough, but I've forgotten who this is. It was in an article on animal ethics about becoming a vegetarian, where similar issues arise, and they were quoting from somebody else who was talking about slavery. Now, suppose that you lived in, you know, pre-Civil War America, you're opposed to slavery, so of course you do not want to be participating not only in having slaves yourself, but you want to avoid all products that are tainted by slave labor. And what the quote went on to say is, here are the things you would have to avoid, right? You know, you had to avoid, you know, clothing, you had to avoid iron, you had to avoid rope, you had to avoid glue, you had to, absolutely every product in America was tainted directly or indirectly, resources, labor, manufacturing process, whatever it might be, with slavery. It was impossible to avoid. But of course, that doesn't mean then, and so since it's impossible to avoid, so you might as well just go ahead and have slaves, right? You've got to pick your battles.
Okay, great. So I'd like to open it up now in case other people have questions. Just to give you a heads up, we are live streaming this event, so everything you say will be recorded and placed on YouTube forever and ever and ever.
But will not be used against you in a court of law.
except the microphone won't pick up your voice too well. So if you could please keep your questions concise, and then Walter and Shelley, when they answer your questions, will attempt to repeat it so that those viewing at home can hear what you have to say. So who has a question or a comment or an objection or an argument? Yes.
Yeah, so thanks a lot, both of you. I've got just a follow-up on the answer that you gave, Shelley, on that there's no way to distinguish this group. Because the idea is that what you're doing wrong is that you're being part of a group that's causing harm. He said this guy who's eating cold vegetables in the shower, it's very hard to say what makes him not part of the group other than he's making the difference. But what about if you were more on Walter's mind and you said, well, this guy isn't making a difference either, but he's not part of the group because what defines the group is if everyone acted like him, there would be no problem. That's the sort of criteria for entry in the group. And if everyone acted like the gas guzzler, then there would be a problem. So does that not escape the idea of it?
Good. So I should try to repeat the question for the sake of posterity and YouTube out there. Though you're nicely loud. But so then the thought was, look, here's a way to solve the worry I have. If you try to use a complicity principle, how are you going to pick out who's part of the group? And the answer is, you kind of gave a familiar Kantian-like argument, if everybody did that. The question is really then becomes, what's the that such that if everybody did it? Now, as it happens, in some of these cases, you know, it's driving, right? But there'll be other cases where, you know, Walter does one kind of polluting activity, and I do another kind of polluting activity, and you do a third kind of polluting activity, and she does a fourth kind of polluting activity, and there's no that we can pick out other than everybody together jointly results in a lot of pollution. And if you ask, why isn't the person in the shower one of that group, there's no individual act description that applies to everybody other than, or so it seems to me, these people contributed to the pollution. If they hadn't done it, there would have been less pollution. And so it's got to be that there's some difference like that that we can still point to.
And the only thing I would say is this argument is very common. You know, what if everybody did that? But I always thought, like, that's a really bad argument. There are many things that are totally fine that if everybody did them, they'd be horrible. You know, like not having any kids. If everybody had no kids, it'd be horrible. But you know, the race would die out. But that doesn't mean it's morally wrong to decide to not have any kids. So I don't think you can choose what's right or wrong for in a particular case by asking what if everybody did that. There's also the problem of what's that.
No, and indeed, just to follow up on that thought as well. And so you start saying, you've saved the test arguably by saying, what if everybody in a context in which this many people were doing it, what about then? But then I think you're just going to go back to, okay, so in this context, does this individual action make a difference or not?
Other questions? Yes.
I think that I found interesting that there is a particular amount of force we're taking a consequentialist perspective. I feel that that deontological perspective is like not so popular. So if we focus specifically on the consequentialist, we are assuming that all these actions are actually private. That it is my decision if I do that, and my molecules of carbon monoxide are not going to make any difference, so I will spend it as much as I want. But even if we take into account the calculations, like Bentham's calculations, there's actually some space for how my actions are going to have some impact in the people that are around me. So it's like an assumption that there's this, that all my actions are actually private. And I'm having a private boycott to McDonald's since 1983, and McDonald's doesn't know anything about it. I don't think that's a boycott. I'm not boycotting McDonald's. I'm boycotting McDonald's when my actions are actually having some sort of public impact. So it's not just the boycott is not only measurable in molecules of carbon. Is also measurable in the amount of influence that it can have on other people, maybe in things more concrete than global warming that is so relativized in our day. But if I know that, I don't know, I don't want to go to Hobby Lobby, people will know that it is actually one item from Hobby Lobby. It's as concrete as that, and it is not just my action. It is a boycott as much as I tell people why is it wrong, and then I can apply some pressure. So should we just give up on that idea on collective consequences of our private actions?
Summarize the question first.
That's right. There was a lot in the question, but part of it was, can it count as a boycott when it's purely private? It seems like it's not a boycott. If we want to talk about boycotts, we should be talking about collective actions and the possibility of those collective actions having beneficial consequences. And I want to say, I mean, I would say, I want to ask both questions. What about my private action? What about, a collective boycott? If the collective boycott is big enough and is going to do good, then yeah, I'm for the collective boycott. But that doesn't mean that I as an individual am required to join that boycott. So it depends on whether the collective boycott depends on my particular participation. If it does in any way, and if the boycott has good consequences, then yes, I think you should join it. But if it doesn't really matter to the boycott or to the people around you whether you join the boycott, then I don't see on what basis I'm morally required to, although it still might be a good thing.
So again, what we're trying to do is figure out how you can make the maximal impact in the battles you choose to join. And clearly you're much more likely to have an impact when, we said this earlier, when there's a collectively organized, publicized, right? And so you've now announced to everybody that you're boycotting McDonald's. Everybody on YouTube is now hearing that you're boycotting. So now it's a boycott.
And indeed,
here's just a fun fact. I've been boycotting McDonald's since 1972. So it turns out exactly. Arlo Guthrie in Alice's Restaurant says, one person is just weird, but two's an organization, three's a movement. If one other person joins us, we've got a movement.
Hey, I haven't been to McDonald's in 20 years.
Yes.
And some critics of consequentialism thought that it strives to separate your notion of negative responsibility. That if we are responsible for the things that happen that are bad, so are we morally responsible for all these things that we're letting happen?
Want to go first? All right. So
you have to repeat.
Yeah. So the question was: look, the kind of consequentialism that Walter and I share. Actually, I just want to just jump back to the earlier remark for a moment, because the questioner just before said, "Look, deontology is a kind of a minority view." It's a sociological fact that's probably not true. This is just, we're kind of a statistical blip here. Deontological approaches, which are alternative approaches where you think about these things beyond consequences, that's probably the majority view among the population as a whole, and maybe even among
I'm not really sure because there are a lot of economists out there.
but are they moral?
But back to that.
So you're right. Under the kind of broadly consequentialist approach, where you have to say, look, the question is just, what's the upshot of my living the way I live? And it has no deep moral significance whether I, from this perspective, brought about the bad result or merely allowed the bad result that I could have corrected. This ties into the question that Jeff was raising earlier about, doesn't this lead to a very demanding moral theory, right? And this is, and I admit it indeed. I insist on it. I think we all ought to be giving away much more of our income, I mean, huge amounts of our income to charity. And so indeed, I embrace the conclusion that many people would take to be an objection to this sort of view. However, you could say, no, morality is much less demanding. But for all that, there are certain cases where you really shouldn't be helping making things worse. And then you're still back to the debate that Walter and I are having. Because if it really is true that when I drive my car, there's a chance that I'll be part of a group of, again, just to stick with the arbitrary threshold, 1,000 people, and that extra 1,000 people will result in the temperature going up, you know, 1/100th more of a degree centigrade. And because of that extra whatever, then that ice flow melted. And so then that gust went down. And that's, you know, then it seems to me even somebody who doesn't believe in a doctrine of negative responsibility is still going to have to worry, wait a minute, I'm making things worse. Or at least I have a chance, there's a chance that I'm making things worse. And that itself then might be reason for refraining from engaging this kind of behavior.
So I guess I would just say my type of consequentialism is not as demanding. Instead, it sets forward ideals. I mean, I think what the principle of utility or consequentialism says is you ought to do what's best for the world. But ought doesn't mean you have to, you must do it. It's wrong not to. You've got an obligation. You've got a duty. It doesn't mean any of that stuff.
Yes, it does.
No. And so I want to distinguish those two. And then I think you can do that within consequentialism.
You can still invite people to your birthday party, but they really must do all those things.
I disagree. So notice even within consequentialists, you can have, you know, different levels of demandiness. But notice that to what extent is it just a verbal description? You demand it, you say it's wrong. Right, I go, well, it'd be a lot better. You know, that's a pretty bad thing to do.
We're both agreeing it shouldn't be punished.
Yeah,
right.
So that's right.
So there are deep theoretical differences, but it's not clear there's much practical difference.
The practical difference in these kinds of cases is what types of sanctions are appropriate for people who fail. It seems to me, and that's and that we might agree on, even if we're using the terms differently.
Yes.
Like we all know, we've had our encounter different parts of the earth, we've had different ages. So if the earth is actually going to get destroyed eventually, without we driving or having a free joyride as the world would have any moral obligation at all. Like if the world is eventually going to end, we have to be worried about the moral obligation.
The question is, you got to repeat the question. Question is, if the world is going to end anyway, then does it make any difference? Well, sure, I think it does. The world is going to end. In 4 billion years, we're going to be engulfed by the sun, okay? And so, does that mean that it doesn't make any difference if I kill Shelley right now? No, it still makes a difference. what happens in the long run doesn't always mean that what we're doing right now doesn't matter, because if I kill Shelley right now, there'll be no Shelley to, you know, to and participate in these very instructive debates and have these wonderful, and I'm looking forward to the meal and we won't get to have it, and so on. All of that will be lost. And so there will be things lost, even if in the long run, everything's lost, because it's the long run when it's lost.
I actually agree completely. I mean, there's much more to say about why does anything matter at all, but that really is a debate for another day.
Amy, and then.
So it just seems to me like the case of not taking Sunday drive is a super weird case of boycotting, because it seems like when I boycott something, I'm trying to get other people not to do it because I think they should do it. And also I'm trying to get, if I say I'm not going to buy Under Armour anymore, it's because I want the Under Armour CEO to change his political behavior. So boycotts are directed at the agency of other consumers and the agency of business people. So that suggests that even if consequences are what matter, the mechanisms are totally different than like not causing carbon to go into the atmosphere. The mechanisms are mechanisms about my affecting the choices that other people make. Why is the Sunday driving case of boycott?
So that's the question was, why is the sun driving for fun on Sunday? Why is that case a boycott when boycotts are aimed at companies and getting other people to go along and trying to change the company behavior? And I'm perfectly happy to say it's a stretch of the word boycott. If you don't want to call it a boycott, that's fine with me. But I think the same thing would apply if you added those two features. So if I said, for example, I'm sitting there on the Sunday afternoon and I say, well, you know, I could refuse to go for the drive. And I know these friends of mine are walking instead of driving, and I would be joining them. And maybe my not driving on this Sunday is going to take some of the political clout away from the oil companies because I'm not going to be buying their products quite as much or something like that. And then it sounds more like a boycott. But my claim is, even in that case, if I were to go, nah, I'm going for a drive, it wouldn't be morally wrong for a number of reasons that I already went through.
I mostly agree. That is to say, you're probably right about the use of the word boycott in English, but in some sense, as far as Walter and I are concerned, the deeper issues are the underlying questions. Can there be cases that have this, as it's sometimes called, collective action structure, where together we bring about a really bad result, or a really good result? You know, if a million of us boycotted McDonald's, right, then maybe McDonald's would change the way they treat their labor and so forth. But the question is, will your individual boycotting or not make a difference? And so that's the question we've been focusing on. I did want to say one other thing, though, about your particular question about the, trying to avoid joining a boycott of a company because you disagree with the political stance of the owner, who's taking all those profits. So I find that actually a very intriguing question. I mean, genuinely, unlike everything else where I'm prepared to just pontificate endlessly, I'm here really of two minds about this. So I remember, 30 years ago, when I lived in Chicago, the president of Domino's, the owner of Domino's, was right-wing. I forget what he was, but it was bad. Right. I'm old, I can't remember anymore, but it was bad, right? And so the people had a boycott about Domino's, don't buy from Domino's Pizza, right? So I was troubled by that because I thought I could easily imagine the tables being turned where, some left-wing person, the Republicans are saying, I don't remember what he's doing, but it's bad, some left bleeding heart tree-hugging granola stuff, right? And so I found myself uncertain as to whether or not that was an adequate ground for boycotting. I'll just extend the anecdote slightly. I'm curious what Walter thinks about that political question. But I asked, because I was puzzled, I asked my colleague, Jerry Dworkin, who's a very fine moral philosopher, about this. I said, look, I'm thinking about not eating from Domino's, getting the pizza from Domino's because of the political, and CEO. What do you think? And Jerry's answer was, why are you ordering that crap? There are so much better pizza places in Chicago. So I never really did get the answer.
Yeah, I mean, I'm certainly, you know, worrying about boycotts on both sides, and whether the tendency to use boycotts for liberal causes is going to lead to more boycotts for causes that I might disagree, that I would disagree with. But I think there's also an element of sometimes you boycott somebody who's actually on your side and has your political views. One of the very first boycotts I ever participated in was a boycott of Gallo wine because of the way they treated their the field workers. And so I boycotted it for a long time. This is a great costume because I love Gallo Gewürztraminer. It was one of the great $3 bottles of wine back then. And so I went through this great costume.
That was real money in those days.
Yeah.
That was like $6.
I was young. And so then a couple of years into the boycott, what I found out was why they had picked Gallo as their target. Now, I never found out whether this is actually true, but what I was told was that they picked the people at Gallo because Gallo had been better to their workers and had been trying to get the other companies to be better to their workers. And so they thought that the boycott would actually be more likely to get Gallo to change their practices than the other people that they had no chance of affecting. And they thought if they could get Gallo to change, it would then change the other people. So now all of a sudden I'm boycotting against somebody who's actually the best of the bunch among, and I'm going off to buy the other kind of wine that's treating their field workers worse. That did bother me. And so I don't know what the answer is, but those are really tricky problems when you start mixing the, you know, the when you start boycotting just for the political views instead of to bring about an effect.
Yes.
So a lot of the debate so far has been about cases in which the question is whether my joining will be enough to prove a bad. But I want to sort of flip things around and ask about whether it's morally bad to be a free rider. So imagine the case of a boycott, let's say the boycott of North Carolina following the bathroom of Law 82, and lots of businesses are boycotting North Carolina, refusing to do business here, canceling plans for expansion. And let's say that I had good reason to believe that the boycott was going to be effective, and that there was enough businesses already boycotting North Carolina that my additional boycotting it wasn't going to make a difference. And I think that North Carolina is a beautiful state, and I'd love to set up my new headquarters there. So I think, look, the boycott's already going to be effective. It doesn't matter whether I join it or not. It's already going to have its intended effect. You know, the governor's not going to get reelected, and so on and so forth. And I'd really love to have my headquarters there. So is it morally wrong for me to say, look, the boycott's going to work anyway. I'm just going to go ahead and set up my headquarters.
So the question was, in a situation where you know that the boycott, or indeed just more generally, you know, the cause, whatever the cause that you support is going to succeed, whether or not you participate, it's just guaranteed, you know, whatever the reasons you got, is it okay to just, you know, come to North Carolina anyway, you know, buy the food at the store that people are boycotting because you know they're going to change the policies anyway? This is a very nice case where the difference between thinking like a consequentialist and thinking like a deontologist comes in. The deontologist is going to say something like, a typical deontologist is going to say something like, no, you're still, you know, the objection as you raised it was, you're free riding, that's objectionable. You're part of the group of people who are the problem, right? That's my own view is, of course, you know, I want to hear more about how you really know it was going to happen for sure. But if it really is the case that you could do some good by not participating in the boycott and the boycott is assured of success, then what you're really just asking is, should you throw away the opportunity to do some good? So just to show you, and so I think the answer is no, you shouldn't throw away the opportunity. And just to show you how, from a deontological perspective, extreme an answer that is, let me just twist the knife on my side, right? You know, so there's the five people who are stabbing Caesar. That's gonna be enough to kill him, right? And suppose somebody comes along and says, and if you stab, says to Brutus, if you stab Caesar too, I'll give these $10 to Oxfam. you should stab Caesar too. That is actually what I think you should do, provided, unrealistically, of course, provided that you know for sure that you're not going to encourage other people to engage in further assassination attempts and so forth.
So I want to, this is a great example of how it really matters what kind of boycott it is, who's directing, what the details are. Because notice, in the business case, there's competition between businesses. So if you get an advantage over your competitor by putting your headquarters into the state when the competitor was boycotting the state, and now all of a sudden you've got a bigger market share, you've got your headquarters really cheap with a long lease because they couldn't sell it to anybody else and so on, you're now gaining advantages for yourself at the loss of other people. Not like the driving case, right, where that none of that competition was going on. Then I think there is something unfair about you taking advantage of the fact that other people are doing the boycott. Now, I would still move into the state, put my headquarters there, but I would take all that extra money and give it to the people who were hurt by the failure to boycott earlier.
Yes, and then yes.
So I have a question for Professor Kagan. So based on your logic, in the case of the driving boycott, are we morally required to, like, for example, slower breath to produce less CO2 into the air?
Good. So the question was, look, if I were right that you were obligated to not drive the gas guzzler car, doesn't it also follow that you're obligated to hold your breath as long as you can, or you know, swallow the breath back in, or something like that? So this is analogous to the. This is analogous to. I think Walter, who's much bigger than I am, probably is breathing more, and he's the one who should hold.
I'm so sorry, Charles. I'm so sorry.
But I talk more, so I'm probably taking more breaths. Yeah. So. Look, this is akin to the question that got raised earlier about, look, isn't it relevant to think about the cost to you of participating? Walter didn't say he was going to die if he can't drive the car to the hospital and get the operation he needs. He was saying he'd have to stroll through the country instead of riding through the country, and his hair won't be tussled quite the same way, right? So a lot turns on what's it going to cost you to participate. And of course, if I stop breathing, that would be a very, very big cost. And so we could imagine a kind of spectrum of cases where the good that you would do stays fixed, but the cost, the sacrifice involved to you of doing it gets larger and larger and larger, or smaller and smaller, depending on which direction you're going. And then, you know, different people might disagree about how big a sacrifice you have to make for the sake of making the world a better place. That's this other issue about just how demanding is morality after all. But I certainly don't think, no, you need to stop breathing in order to do your bit. That probably wouldn't be the most effective way for you to fight climate change anyway.
So let me just say a word about that, because I think the point you're making is really good, but I agree with Shelley about the slowing down your breathing. What you should do is not do anything that's going to speed up your breathing, right? So you should not gesticulate with your arms, right?
Who are you pointing to, Walter?
Because that's going to make you breathe faster, and you don't really need to.
Yes.
And all that back patting.
Yeah, put it into that too.
What the reason is, Scythian boycott, in the traditional boycott context, what the reason is of that agent, because typically it's an agent on the other end, why they change the behavior. Does the consequentialist care and all about why did that moral agent change behavior in the context of the boycott? Because I would assume that most of the time the change of behavior is not due to kind of recognizing moral force boycott. It's the economic harm, typically. That's why the boycott is, you know, it's designed to be economic.
So were you asking about the motives of the individual consumer who's boycotting, or the CEO?
The target of the boycott.
Target of the boycott. So, excuse me. The question was, do the motives of the target for changing, you know, so we'd like them to change because they now care about the environment, but in fact they're just going to change because their profit line is going down. So do their motives matter? And I think the answer is, depends on what question you're asking. If you're
so
it's not just consequentialists who are going to want to distinguish in the way that I'm about to distinguish, but I think anybody should want to distinguish the question, did they do the right thing in changing their corporate policies? And that's a separate question from, are they a nice person, right? So if, when the person jumps into the pond and saves the drowning child, that's the right thing to do, regardless of whether they did it because it's the right thing to do, or they did it because the father is standing there saying, save my drowning child and I'll give you a reward of $10,000. Right? So it's one thing to ask, good person, bad person. Another thing to ask, did they do the right thing or not? And that's a distinction that not just consequentialists want to draw. I think any moral, you know, anybody thinking about morality should draw that kind of question. And so then the answer to that is no. They're probably going to do it for the wrong motives. CEOs are not generally known for their outstanding moral character. I mean, there are exceptions, but they're not generally known for that. But for all that, it could still be that it was the right thing to do.
Yeah, so I totally agree with the distinction between, you know, the act and the person. But I give the different answer to your question, which is I think consequentialists should care about how the target of the boycott is motivated. And the reason is that you can pick which form of boycott you're going to adopt. And some forms of boycott might tell Gallo Wine reluctantly, okay, fine, I'll do something for the damn workers, I still don't like them. Whereas another form of boycott might make them realize that these workers are people that deserve to be treated with respect, and then they start treating them with respect for the, you know, out of the motivation of wanting to treat them with respect. And my suspicion is that the second form of boycott is going to have longer term, better consequences than the first form of boycott. So if you can, in addition to bringing the target of the boycott along with you, if you can bring them along for the right reasons, then that's going to be better. You want the Montgomery Bus Company to not just kind of reluctantly say, okay, fine, we'll let black people into the front of the bus. You want them to say, damn it, they deserve to be allowed in the front of the bus. We're glad to have them in the front of the bus. We're happy to end segregation. That would make everybody a lot better off. And so we ought to formulate our boycotts so as to bring about those beneficial effects and not just the change in behaviors.
It might be you, even with the consequentialist, and this is
the yes.
criticism, you don't just treat moral agents as if there are any other lever of consequences that you could achieve. They might be different in a way that has to be taken into account, and maybe consequentialist viewpoints don't adequately respect that fact.
That consequentialist viewpoint don't adequately respect what?
The fact that you're using another human being as the lever of your consequence, right? Of how you're achieving your consequences.
So the complaint is that if you're a consequentialist boycotter, you're using the target of your boycotting as a means to get to achieve the goal.
If you're not appealing to their
their respect for other people, so a Kantian might say that's a reason to favor what I described as a second boycott, which convinces them that they ought to be behaving better instead of the first, where they're doing it reluctantly only for their self-interest. A deontologist might say that's another reason, but I think a consequentialist has plenty of reason already. To say we ought to formulate our boycotts so that people end up going, darn it, they're right. I should have been treating these people better.
We have time for one final question. Matt?
So I find myself at least somewhat inclined to boycott large corporations who have viewpoints that are different from my own. But I don't find myself at all inclined to do that for more local interactions. If I'm going to hire someone to do my taxes or, you know, frequent a local restaurant or something like that. I really don't care at all what political views are of people. I was wondering if you see any rational, I mean, I'm not sure I see any rational basis for this
thinking. The claim or question was just that there's a, that the questioner revealed of himself that
confessed.
Yeah, that would be he confessed. He opened his heart to us and confessed that he's happy to boycott large impersonal corporations because of their political views and CEOs, companies, what have you, but not for local. And so I'm just intrigued by that. So I'm going to ask you to confess a bit more. So this is just an example. By means of, in hopes of preparing for this, I was reading a book about consumer choices over the last week or so, and they had the very nice example where you're at the local farmer's market, right? And they have a sign up above the vegetable bin saying, "You know, we proudly give 10% of all our profits to the Aryan Nation." Are you really telling me you wouldn't have qualms at that point?
Matthew Hodson, associate.
Global local distinction was settled in that. I'm not an eBay guy. I don't really care what his views are about, you know, hey, he supports Trump, but whatever. I don't, you know, I'm just buying it.
Because you don't know. But if, again, if his eBay site had little swastikas on it, you know, saying, you know, 10% of all our eBay earnings go to supporting white supremacy, take back our country, you would care, wouldn't you? Yeah. Okay. Me too.
Yeah. Me too.
So Matt, you're a better person than you think. Okay.
So I guess we can agree on that.
Yes.
All right. Well, thank you, Walter and Shelley, and thank you everybody for coming. Of course, and thank you again to IA, Tess, and Templeton for sponsoring us. Again, if you'd like to fill out the survey, you can follow that link, post it over there. And now, based on what you've decided, go live either an impoverished life or a very fulfilled life.
Oh, so I don't remember this one. Are you guys?
That was great.
So I haven't written my book on consequentialism, but it's going to be a contrastive version of consequentialism.
This is better than that.